It is great to be with you this morning, and I want to again welcome those that are joining us online. And again, we have this Canton Nazarene Connect app. We have fill in the blank notes. So I'd encourage you, if you're not planning on taking notes this morning, take notes, all right? You retain more. And then we're going to be going through a special prayer that is in the notes section of the app at the end of the service. You want to have that actually all week and throughout the series. And really throughout the rest of this month, maybe the rest of your life, because it's going to be really helpful for us in this area of forgiveness. So just to review a little bit, last week we talked about church hurt, and when people hurt us in the church, sometimes it hurts even worse than people outside the church because we have higher expectations, right, of one another and leaders. And so it can be very, very painful, because when someone hurts you, they create a debt, right? They create a debt. So you get hurt. They create a debt. They take something from you. They take away your self-esteem or your self-confidence. They may take away friends. They may take away hopes or dreams or purity. They could take away so many things, and that creates this debt in our lives, this loss. And so we learn that forgiveness is a choice. Forgiveness is about saying, I will cancel that debt. It doesn't make it right. It doesn't take away the hurt. It doesn't say that that's okay that they did that to us. But it does free us from living a tortured life of bitterness and holding this resentment in our hearts. So we often think that forgiveness is for the offender, and in part it is, but really, forgiveness is for us. And it's for us because we know the cross is for us, because in God's great mercy, He forgave all of our sins, and so in return, we should forgive people when they sin against us. Forgiveness is for you. So you may say, well, you know, I think I can maybe cancel the debt of some people that have hurt me in the past, and I've been holding on to this. Maybe you did that this week, and that's a great step. But you're thinking to yourself, what about the people that are hurting me right now? What about the people I'm going to go to work tomorrow, and I just know they're going to hurt me because they hurt me all the time, or maybe in your house, or maybe at school, or maybe they're just waiting for you. They're consistent with it. They just bring hurt into your life, you know. How do I handle them? Well, let me ask you some questions to kind of lean into this for a moment, just to maybe get you thinking in this way. Do you work with people who are mean, deceptive maybe, backstabbing, selfish, or angry? Do you live with people? Do you live with people who are controlling? They want to control you all the time. They're abusive maybe. Maybe unfaithful? Do you run into random people who are so nasty? You just ask, like, what is up with them? I've ran into some of those people on the roads this week. I have no idea what their issue is, but they keep beeping at me. Are you in a relationship with someone who has trust or self-esteem issues? Did you adopt out of love, and now that child is a teenager or maybe a young adult, and despite all of your love, they're just angry and they're rebellious, and you don't know why. You see, all of us bump into people. We bump into people in the world, in our families, at school, at work, in recreation. We bump into people, and we don't know why they're so angry. We don't know why they act the way they do, but it usually comes back to what I want to talk about today with you, and that's family of origin hurt. It usually always comes back to this. Way back when, someone in their family hurt them. And when they got hurt, they got angry. And when they got angry, they held on to that anger. And so it's unresolved anger. And they act in ways, and you're bumping in them today, and you'll bump into them in the future, and they will do things and treat you, and you're like, what's going on? It always usually comes back to this. Now, one of my favorite shows is This Is Us. Anyone watch This Is Us just quickly? This Is Us. This is the best show on family of origin hurt. If you don't know what it is, just maybe watch a few episodes. Because what this show does is it goes back in time, and it shows childhood circumstances and happenings. And then it kind of goes into the middle part of their life and then goes into present time. And you see how all of this is connected. One of the stories like right now is Randall. And Randall is a black man. And he was adopted by a white family, a very loving white family. And he is dealing with some family of origin hurt because he's hurt. Not really knowing why his biological parents gave him up. So there's this deep hurt, like why? Why did they give me up? Even though I have a loving family, that still hurts. And then he's also experiencing hurt because when you're black and you're raised in a white family and predominantly a white culture, I'm just saying there's some hurt that comes along with that. And this show is really exploring that right now, and it's relevant to what we're seeing in culture. And what we learn from Randall is that unresolved anger becomes a pathway. Unresolved anger, it's like a time machine, okay? It's a pathway from the past to the present. Because what happens is the hurt from the past becomes the hurt of the present. And then the anger of the past becomes the anger of the present. And then the debts of the past become the debts of the present. Debts like the understanding that we never got. Debts like the apology that we never got. Debts like the forgiveness that we never got. Debts like the time from our parents that we never got. Debts like the acceptance for who we are that we never got. Debts from the acknowledgement of achievement that we never got. You know, debt from the mother or father that we never had, like Randall's dealing with in this show. You know, debt from the freedom to pursue your dreams. The freedom to pursue your dream. You're doing something now that you really never wanted to do because you didn't get the permission to pursue your dreams from your parents. You never got that. And with family of origin hurt, see, it's a pathway from the past to the present because we carry that anger. And the unresolved anger, it's like an untreated wound. So if I had this wound on me that was untreated and it's covered up by my clothes, you would never know that it's here, that I'm carrying this wound. But if you bump into that wound, you're going to experience my wound, right? And that's how unresolved anger works. You don't see the wound. You don't see the hurt because you weren't even there. But you're bumping into people in culture, at work, in your family, somewhere along the line. And you are experiencing that wound. And you bump into them and they react. And you're scratching your head saying, I had nothing to do. I didn't do anything to you. Why are you treating me this way? Because of family of origin hurt. Because they have unresolved anger and hurt and debt in their life. And so today, what I want to do is help us understand that number one, this can be overcome, and number two, how to do it. Because if anger is left unresolved, you will never get over the wound, you'll never experience the healing, and you may really never understand the people around you and why they're treating you the way they are. But this is very vital that we experience this healing, because if someone in the family at some point doesn't decide to forgive, it'll just keep going on from generation to generation. And the hurt of the past will keep being the hurt of the present. It'll be the hurt of the future. But someone in the family along the way has to make a decision that enough is enough and that we need to forgive and break that chain. So I'm going to give you an example with Joseph of one person that actually did this, and then we're going to look at how we can do this. Paul shares some insight in the book of Ephesians, so we're going to be in Genesis and Ephesians this morning if you want to open up your Bibles, or again, follow along on the app. All the scriptures are there for you. So, Joseph. Joseph was this young man. He was 17 years old, and he had a bunch of brothers. But here's the thing about Joseph. He was the favorite. He was the favorite of all the brothers. Mom and dad loved him more than the rest. And we read this in Genesis chapter 37, verse 4. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. So, some of you may have experienced this family of origin hurt. You have siblings, and you are not the favorite. They are the favorite, and you resent them for that. You had no control over it. Mom and dad just liked them better than they liked you. You couldn't control it, but it happened, and you've always resented your brother. You've always resented your sister. You have never liked them. In fact, you hate their guts. This is where Joseph was, right? And Joseph, he didn't do the brightest thing in the world, you know, when he understood this, because Joseph has this dream about these sheaves, and he's one of the sheaves, and all of his brothers are the other sheaves, and he has this dream where all the sheaves bow down to him. So basically he tells his brothers, I'm the sheave, you're the other sheaves, I'm the favorite, and I had this dream, and you bow down to me. How do you think that went over with his brothers? All right, not the brightest move, right? Well, to make it even worse, we read, then he had another dream. So he has this dream, tells his brother. Then he has this other dream, and he told it to his brothers. He said, I had another dream, all right? And this time, the sun, all right, look up, guys, the sun and the moon and 11 stars were bowing to me. No wonder they hated this guy, right? I mean, he was already the favorite. And now he's having dreams of saying, you know, all these dreams, you guys are bowing down to me, and now all of nature is bowing down to me, right? I am the man. I am the favorite. So, you know, that didn't go over well with his brothers. They already hate his guts. So they have this plan that we're going to get rid of Joseph. We're going to get rid of him. And so they're out in the fields one day, and they decide they're going to throw him in this hole. And they're going to wait for the wild animals to eat him. You know, pretty good plan, right? You know, pretty good plan. So some of the brothers are like, no, that's a little too harsh. Let's just sell him off into slavery. That's a better solution. Let's just sell him as a slave. Maybe that'll be better. So Genesis 37, 28. So when the Midianite merchants came by, these are the slave traders. These are the Jawas in Star Wars. Here they come. They're coming by. His brothers pulled Joseph out of the cistern, out of the hole, and sold him for 20 shekels, 20 shekels of silver. They sold him. They probably divvied up the money, right, to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt. So they get rid of Joseph. So the story goes, Joseph is in Egypt. The Bible tells us he's wise and discerning, so he kind of climbs the ranks in Egypt. There's this great famine that comes, and Joseph is so instrumental in navigating Egypt through this famine. He sees this coming along, makes plans, makes preparations, and he saves just so many lives, saves so many Egyptian lives, saves Israelite lives, and it's actually through what he did that he comes back into contact with his brothers. Now, at this point, he's like 56 years old. So, you know, almost 40 years or so have passed, and he's lived with this deep family of origin hurt. I mean, he's lived with this for a lifetime. And his brothers come back to Egypt to get food. And we come to this scene where Joseph is now in this place of power. I mean, Joseph is now where he can finally pay his brothers back. I mean, he's had all of these years to think about how he can get them back. And he has the perfect opportunity because he's in such power. He can do anything he wants to his brother. And we come to this moment. It's like the climax of the story. And here is what Joseph does. But Joseph said to them, don't
be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done. And what's being done? The saving of many lives. So then, brothers, who threw me in a pit. So then, brothers, who sold me off to slavery when I was 17. So then, brothers, who I've had this in my life for 40 years and I've been waiting for this moment. So then, brothers, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he reassured them, because they're scared to death at this point. They know. And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. So here's my question. How did he do that? I mean, how do you do that? How do you do that when someone that you grew up with betrayed you and hurt you in such a way after 40 years and you're in the place where you can finally get them back? How do you get to the place where you ask the question, am I in the place of God, and you forgive your brothers that hurt you so dearly? How do you do it? So I was like, why doesn't Genesis tell us how he did it? Because it doesn't. So disappointing. It just kind of ends. It just kind of ends. And so that's why we're going to Ephesians for some help from the Apostle Paul. Because Paul, he writes to this church, and this is kind of the context of this letter we know as Ephesians. He writes to this church about Jesus Christ, and the first half of it's all theology. It's about why Jesus Christ is the Savior, why Jesus Christ is the Messiah. He just kind of breaks it down, lays out. You should read Ephesians this week. He just lays out the case for Christ and why he is the Lord and the Savior of all theologically. And then the second half of the letter, he says, because of this, because Jesus is who he is, and because we say that we follow Jesus, this is how you should live. In the second half of Ephesians, it's almost like bullet points. Like, this is how you should live. If you say you follow Jesus Christ, this is what it means to follow Jesus Christ in the world. This is what it means to be different in the world. And it gives us some amazing insight into how to forgive family of origin hurt. So in Ephesians 4, 26, he says, in your anger, because you'll get angry, do not sin. In your anger, do not sin. Another translation says it this way, be angry. Be angry. It's like a command. Be angry. I kind of like that. Be angry. All right, I can do that one. Be angry, all right? Here's the hard part. And, all right, I'm not done. Be angry. You're going to get angry. It's normal to be angry when someone hurts you, when someone takes something away from you. It's normal to be angry. So don't do the Christian thing and say, oh, I never get angry. No, you can be a Christian and be angry. You're commanded to, okay? Be angry. But here's the hard part. And yet do not sin. That's the hard part, because when I get angry, I do things and I say things that I wish I would have never done and wish I would have never said. So, one time, you know, Andy and I got into a fight, right? Got into a fight. And we really don't fight a whole lot. And when we do fight, it's pretty mild. But this fight was different. And this fight, I don't know who raised their voice first. I'll say she did, okay? She raised her voice first, and then I raised my voice a little bit, and then she raised her voice back at me, and then I got a little louder, and then she got louder, and I got louder, and this had really never happened in our marriage relationship, and I could just feel the anger building up in me. And then before you knew it, I slammed the door, and then I walked away from her. I turned my back on her, and I remember I was getting farther from her, and I had to yell louder at her because I heard her say something, and I spouted back off. And I mean, this is like filling up the house now with me and her shouting at each other. Now, what I had forgotten was our daughter Marley was in her room, and she heard all of this going on. So I'm down in the living room sitting on the couch, and I can just feel this rage, right? And then here comes my daughter down, and she's kind of teary-eyed, and she was like, "Dad, is everything okay with you and Mom?" So when you see your daughter, you know, tearing up and asking that question, you want to talk about feeling about this big. That's about how big I felt. And I was like, "Honey, We got in an argument, but things will be okay." So I said, "I'm sorry that I lost control, and I apologize. It shouldn't have happened." So I apologized to my daughter, but I was still angry at Andy. I wasn't ready to apologize to her. Not at all. Not at all. While anger is not sin, unresolved anger grows when we stay angry. And that's what was happening to me on that couch. You know, I made it right with my daughter, but I didn't make it right with my wife because I was mad, and it was growing. It was not over. It was not over. And that's why Paul says this: "Be angry and don't sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry." Now, my question is, does Paul mean this literally or figuratively? Because I did some research, and I found out that in Alaska, the sun never goes down for about 3 months. So if you want to be angry and stay angry and follow God's word, all you have to do is take a flight to Alaska. In fact, it's coming up. I think it's May through July. It's coming up. You can fly up there, and you can just be angry for a long time over the person that's hurt you, okay? So is it literal or is it figurative? Is he saying, if you get angry, all right, don't sin, but get it handled as soon as you can? Well, that anger built in me and built in me, and you know what I did? I went to bed angry. I went to bed angry. And then when I got up, you know how I felt? Even worse. And I stayed angry for another day. And I went to bed angry again a second night. You know how I felt the next morning? Even worse. And I'm like, "Dan, what are you doing? Why can't you let go of the anger? Why can't you let go of this fight? What is going on with you?" But what I was learning is that unresolved anger opens a pathway to sin. See, it opens a pathway to sin. And what I was doing at that point is I was sinning. I was sinning. I had fallen short. I had missed the mark. I was not acting and behaving the way a husband should. Not at all. I was in sin at that point because unresolved anger, it opens a pathway to sin. And this is what may explain some things that are happening in your life or the people that are in your life. Because if we let the sun go down on our anger day after day, you know, week after week, month after month, if it keeps setting, what happens is over time, we may forget even where the anger came from. You see, in the argument that we had, I can tell you today, I don't even remember what it was over. And with family of origin hurt, when you're hurt way back when and you let the sun set on it over and over and over again, and it's decades later, and you look back and you know you're angry, you know you're upset, but you don't even know why, because you've let the sun set so many times, you forget where the source was. That's the danger of it. And it's also a danger because this unresolved anger, it affects every relationship in your life. I mean, it affects the people in your house, the people you work with, the people you play with. I mean, it just goes on and on. And when you have this unresolved anger, you can just stuff it inside. And if you stuff it inside, eventually you'll get depressed. And if you let it out, this unresolved anger, if you let it out, you go the opposite way. Do you know what happens in your life? You become violent. And things happen, like shootings at a FedEx facility in Indianapolis. And things happen, like a man walking into the Bob Evans just a couple miles from where we sit this morning and murdering his girlfriend at Bob Evans at around 10:30 or 9:30 in the morning on Friday. You see, when anger goes unresolved, when family of hurt origin goes unresolved long enough, and when the sun sets on it over and over and over again, I'm just telling you, it opens a pathway to sin, and people will do things that they never thought they would do or could do, and they'll say things, and you will bump into them in this world, and you'll be like, what is going on? I never even did anything. It's because they have family of origin hurt. They've never dealt with it. They're angry, and now it has opened a pathway of sin in their life. And you're working with them, and you're playing with them, and you're going to school with them, and you're on the roads with them, and you could be sitting having breakfast at Bob Evans, and one of them could come in and murder someone in front of your eyes, and you could be changed for the rest of your life. That's how serious this is. That's how important it is to deal with. He says, don't give the devil a foothold. You know what that means? Don't give the devil a base camp. Because if you let the sun set on your anger over and over, what you are doing, you are inviting the devil himself. You are saying, I am a camp, I am a base camp, set up residence in my life, devil, and do your bidding through me. Now you may say, well, I'm not going to go out and murder someone or do this or that. You would be surprised of what you're capable of. And you could hurt people, and other people can hurt you, because we don't follow God's word. Here's the answer. Here's the answer. What we need to do is develop a forgiving spirit. What do you mean, Dan? Develop a forgiving spirit. There's a big difference. There's a big difference between someone hurting you, creating a debt, you getting angry, you being upset about it. You come to church, you hear a sermon on forgiveness, you say, okay, all right, God, I forgive you, I cancel the debt, all those things, and then you go on. And then someone else does something, and they hurt you, and you get angry again, and you have a revival, and you go back, and it's just a pattern over and over again. You just keep doing the same thing. You cancel it. You fall into it. You get it right. But it's not what God really desires for your life. It's not what's really going to deal with family of origin hurt. The only thing that will deal with it is if you're able to develop a forgiving spirit. See, this is what Paul says in just a few verses later. Be kind. Remember what Joseph, he spoke kindly to his brothers. Be kind. How did he get there? This is how he got there. Be kind and compassionate. I mean, why didn't he just do everything he could have done to his brothers? Why was he compassionate? This is how he got there. Be kind and compassionate to one another. Forgiving, that's present tense. That means over and over and over, day after day, hurt after hurt, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. So, Pastor, how can I be kind and compassionate? They wounded me. They hurt me. How can I be forgiving to them? How, Paul says, you got to think about this. Just as in Christ God forgave you. Well, then my question is this. All right, Paul, how did God forgive me? How did God forgive you? Beforehand? Beforehand? What's that mean? Before you ever sinned, God decided he was going to forgive you. Before you ever sinned in your past, before you ever sinned in your present, before you ever sinned in your future, God made a decision He would forgive you. God decided beforehand He would not make a case against you. He would not make a case against me. In fact, it was the direct opposite. God decided He was going to make a case to forgive us beforehand. You see, we live in a realm of forgiveness. Now you're saying, I know what you're saying, I know what you're saying, I know what you're thinking. Wait a second, Dan, time out. I have to ask God to forgive me for Him to forgive me. Well, you do have to ask God to forgive you to reconcile yourself back to God, to enter back into a relationship to God, but reconciliation is different than forgiveness. We're going to talk more about that next week. Reconciliation is the end product of forgiveness. Those are two separate things. But God decided beforehand that He was going to cancel your debt. He was going to cancel my debt before we ever sinned. And we live literally in a realm of forgiveness. And that's why if we do go to God and ask God forgiveness, then we are reconciled to Him and the relationship is restored. But your sins, my sins are already forgiven. It has already been decided. At the cross of Calvary, Jesus Christ canceled the debt of all of our sins, and that was God's plan from the beginning, beforehand. Am I in the place of God? See, where we get mixed up is we put ourselves in the place of God. That's what we do. That's what we do. Oh, I'm going to be in the place of God. I'm going to get you back. I'm going to pay you back. I'm not going to listen to your word. I'm going to hold on to the bitters. I'm not going to break the chain of family of origin hurt. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do it my way. I'm going to do it my way. How is that way working for you? See, I don't know. I can't prove this, but I'm pretty sure that this isn't the first time Joseph asked this question when he spoke to his brothers. I think over that 40 years, I mean, think about that hurt. Over that 40 years, God was working on Joseph. And God was trying to restore Joseph and redeem this hurt, you know. And I think it got to the point where Joseph finally said, you know what, I'm not going to hold on to this anymore. I'm going to develop this spirit of forgiveness. And I think one of the ways he developed this spirit of forgiveness where we already know that tomorrow people are going to hurt us and we've already decided it doesn't matter. I'm going to cancel the debt because I have this spirit. I think Joseph asked this question over and over again. I think when the thoughts came and the feelings came and the emotions came and the remembrances came, I think he asked this question, am I in the place of God? Am I in the place of God? Isn't that a humble statement? I mean, am I in the place? Who am I? Am I in the place of God? And what's the answer? No. Oh God, you've been so merciful to me. Oh God, you've been so forgiving of me. Oh God, at the cross, you've been so forgiving, so merciful. Am I in your place, God? Am I in your place? No. I think every morning, Joseph got on his knees. Before the day even began, he said, by faith, whoever's going to hurt me today, whoever's going to offend me today, I already canceled the debt. I'm not in your place, God. They may mean it for my harm, but somehow, God, you're going to work it out for good. They may intend to hurt, but somehow you're going to work it out. Because listen, we are all broken people. We are all broken, sinful people. We have messed up in so many ways. Oh, we need His forgiveness so bad. And people out there that have no idea who God is, or maybe they do, but they're just not following Jesus, they need people with a spirit of forgiveness. A spirit. How do I get that, Pastor Dan? How do I get that? Ernest Hemingway, this famous author, he wrote this story about this father and his son named Paco, and and Paco and his father had had an estranged relationship. You know, there was this undisciplined life by the son, and the son went off. And this went on for years and years and years. And there was so much pain and heartache. And finally, the father had had enough. It's like, I'm done with this. And so he went to the local newspaper, and he put out an ad in the newspaper. And it said this, simply, "All is forgiven, Paco. Meet me in the town square." And so that paper went out the next day. And guess what happened? Hundreds of Pacos showed up in the town square. Why? Because the greatest need that you have, the greatest need that I have, is the need to be forgiven. Am I in the place of God to withhold a decision to cancel the debt? Am I in the place of God to say, you know what? I'm going to build a case against you. Like I'm gonna hold this. I don't think so. And this is not easy. This is very challenging. But this is where we need to get to. And so, on our app again, I talked to you about this at the beginning, but there's this prayer. And my challenge to us this week, my challenge to myself, is every morning, before we do anything, before we get started on our day, every morning that we would come to this and pray this prayer. And I just want to share it with you. I think this is what it's going to take to develop this spirit of forgiveness. Father, Joseph asked, am I in the place of God? Before I start my day, by faith, right now, I acknowledge you are God and I am not. Father, you forgave me beforehand. So before the day begins, anyone who will hurt me is forgiven. I cancel the debt. I refuse to build my case against them. I live in your realm of forgiveness, so they do as well. They owe me nothing. Please allow the hurt I may experience today from the people who have been hurt in the yesterdays be reminders of your mercy and grace in my life. Give me a forgiving spirit. Give me a forgiving spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want you to stand with me at this time. I want you to stand, please. I'd like for you to bow your heads here. And if you're thinking back in your life and you say, you know what, I know the family of origin hurt. I know exactly what it was. And I've been bitter. I've been angry. I've never dealt with it. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If that's you this morning, you know, you remember it. You've really never dealt with it. If that's you this morning, I want you to slip your hand up real quick. Where are you at? Just raise your hand. You know what it was. It hurts. It still hurts. Anyone? Just raise your hand real quick. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Anybody? Anybody? You may say, I'm angry and I'm depressed. I don't know. There's something going on and I don't even really know why, but I want to ask God to help me to identify that source. I've just let the sun set too many times, and I don't even know why, but I know it's there. If that's you, can you raise your hand real quick? Just want to see. Thank you. Anybody else? Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Father, you've seen the hands go up. People that know and they need to deal with it, and they need to develop this spirit of forgiveness. God, I pray for them this week. They would say this prayer every morning. God, you would help develop a spirit of forgiveness in them. They would cancel the debt. God, it's a supernatural work. And then for those, they're confused, they're angry, they're depressed. They don't even know why, but they know something happened. God, I pray that you would reveal that to them. They let the sun set so many times. They don't even know, but they know something's going on. God, would you help them discover that? Would you kind of pull the curtain back so they can start dealing with it and find freedom? God, I pray for all of us. God, I pray for all of us that we could be the ones that, no matter what hurt we've experienced from our family, we could be the ones that would say, you know what? It ends with me. I'm going to cancel the debt. Give me a forgiving spirit. I'm not going to live with bitterness and anger. I'm not going to pass this on to my children and their grandchildren. I'm not going to do it. I accept the healing, God. I want to be like Joseph. Somehow Joseph did it. If you did it for God, Joseph, God, I know you can do it for me. I want that. Am I in the place of God? No. I just pray that you would do that work in our lives. God, we need you. We need you. We need you in this. We need you so much. So help us to be kind and compassionate, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave us. God, when we're angry, help us not to sin. God, don't let us let the sun keep setting. God, don't let us give the devil a foothold. We pray your scripture over us this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name.